We talking about practice. Not a game, not a game. We talking about practice.
I have two candid guys right here who don't mince words. They don't hold back. They'll let you know exactly how they feel. And I was excited about this. I definitely was excited. There's a lot of talk right now. Redskins have the number two pick. There's a lot of talk that perhaps they're going to go after Tua, you know, from quarterback from Alabama. And I don't think so. We need your mics right here. I don't think so. And Brian, we're around the team quite a bit. It would be silly, to say the least, for the Washington Redskins to draft another quarterback when you have a guy in Dwayne Haskins that we saw start to show signs once he got the reps that he needed. So you take it away. Your thoughts?
Well, as I look at it, I call this time of the year lying season because there are a lot of lies coming out of Indianapolis. There'll be a lot of lies coming from every team out there. But if you really listen to the Tua rumors lately, they're basically to make Miami get Tua. Who wants to go to Miami? Tua.
Of course.
Okay, and he says it over and over again. And I really believe, now, if the Redskins are saying anything, they're not telling you what they're doing. They may be saying stuff to make Miami want to come up and give them some picks. But ultimately, I don't think that they're going to go get a quarterback. I listened to Ron, and Ron said that his mentor told him to make your strengths stronger. So if you're going to make his strengths stronger, the strongest part of this football team is the defensive line.
Absolutely.
So if he's going to go by what his mentor taught him, he's going to be getting stronger on the defense.
Chase Young.
So I'm saying Chase Young or make some picks and get a lot of defensive players. I don't see them making that move to go get a quarterback that's been injured. Who is he going to compete with? He's not going to play the first year. You know, it's going to be hard as hell for him to play the first year. So I don't see it.
Ricky?
Hey, I agree. I believe that, you know, Tua, he's not healthy yet, man. You can't go get him, especially with the quarterback that we have now. No one's going to compete with him. And if you brought Tua in, he would have to compete now, and he can't do that. So why even try to even think about go get him?
I mean, and think about it this way. If you want someone to push him to be better, I don't think it's going to be a rookie on top of that who has to learn the system, as you guys say. You need to go out and get yourself a veteran quarterback. You maybe an A.J. McCarron, someone that – I don't think they want someone to come
Andy
in here and
Dalton.
Take Dwayne Haskins' job.
I'd rather get the guy from Cincinnati. What, Andy? Yep. Yeah, man, have him come in.
I think that ship sailed when Jay left.
But see, this is the thing that people are upset because they haven't said he's our guy.
Right.
I don't have a problem with that because you want him to not be comfortable.
I agree.
You want him to keep going. I hit him over social media privately,
right?
And I basically told him, I said, man, just stick to what you've been doing. Don't worry about all the noise you're hearing around you because they want you to get better. And his response was, yes, sir, I got you. So the whole thing about it is, you know, if you are afraid of competition, then you're the wrong guy anyway.
Of course.
Which I know he's not afraid of competition. And I think that's the whole thing. We have a lot of people in this town that are stuck on what happened. And they really are looking at that instead of looking at what's transpiring. And
but that's two of you. That's your fault, though.
No. See, they're not.
He has a Super Bowl ring on.
They're not talking about what happened then. They're still talking about the last 10, 12, 15 years.
Right.
You know, when things were weird. Okay.
Yeah.
And right now, they seem to be righting the ship, and you have a coach who's a motivator.
Yes.
Okay. One thing about Ron Rivera, I was with him in Philadelphia. He's going to motivate you. He's going to get the best out of you. And you're going to still love him afterwards because not only does he push you, he'll praise you when you deserve it. And I think that's the whole thing. We're used to people, Jay, what did he do? Nothing. And he sat up there. He didn't discipline anybody. He didn't praise anybody. He got mad at everybody after the fact.
Threw people under the bus.
So ultimately, I just think that this thing is going to change up. But I don't see a quarterback controversy brewing by no stretch.
No, I agree. And, Ricky, you know, we've talked to Dwayne a lot, you know, and – after every game, we'd go in the locker room, and I would always tell the guy, listen, remember these haters. Remember the naysayers, because when you start doing well, they're going to be the first ones that want to do something with you. You know how that works as former players. I look at Dwayne, though, and I think that clearly his best football is coming, and we saw once he got those reps, once he got the, you know, game play. Once he was out on the field and he saw things, I saw him get better every week. So I don't see how there should be a quarterback controversy.
I just hope that he becomes a pro off the field.
Okay.
Start dressing, hitting his books, looking appropriate. I mean, a lot of times when I see him, that's my dude, but, he got this nonchalant look, don't care about, dude, you the face of the franchise now.
Okay.
So we need you to step up and just be that guy. Always in early, leave late, don't worry about going out, whatever. That time will come because now is your time. So you have to hit the books, as they say.
Let me ask you guys. You guys are Super Bowl champions, the last to do it, in this town. When you look at a team, is it easy for you guys, having won a championship, having won a Super Bowl, is it easy for you to look at a team and say, that team has the look of a champion? Or is it something that is just something that builds and it gets to a stage where it's developed?
Are you talking about this current team that we have?
Or no, just like any team. Because I'll compare it to where this team is.
Okay, well, I look at team during training camp or how they practice during training camp. The whole foundation is built at that point for me. Again, when you saw Jay, when Jay was here, you saw how you have guys doing one-on-ones. Receiver get the ball, it's long. He'll walk and get the ball, then throw it back, then walk back. You cannot do that. So I want to see how training camp is going to be, and that will tell me how this team is going to be during the season.
For me, I'm like Rick. I want to see the type of effort you're giving, because I feel when you give great effort early, it's going to pay off late. But the team we had, we didn't know we were about to go 17-2. But one thing we knew was every day people showed up to work. All of a sudden, we're 7-0. And Coach Gibbs had promised us that we were going to get a day off per win we have for the bye week. We had a bye week after 7.
Okay.
We were 7-0. We would think we were going to get 7 days. We got 7 days, but we didn't get straight 7 days. The man is brilliant. So he had us do 2 days of practice, off for 2 days, practice again. He made sure we practiced 7 days. We got the 7 days off. But I think what happens with football teams is that they get better weekly. So even the Patriots. When the Patriots start a season, I don't know that they're going to win, because right. They normally start the season slow.
They do.
And then all of a sudden you see them start snowballing.
Mm-hmm.
The team we had, we ended up all of a sudden we sitting at 11-1. We finally lost the game. And Monty Cole was like, all right, we 0-0. We got to win the next one. So, boom, we 12-1. 12-1, 13-1, 14-1. We basically treat the last game like a preseason game.
That's
took people
the
out after the first two drives or so. They win. We go into the playoffs, and we just smash people. But it was because every day was competition. And Monty Coleman with those 25-inch arms coming into the locker room at halftime saying, it's 0-0, win the second half. You going to fight him or you going to do what he says?
Yeah, exactly.
So we went out and tried to win.
Another thing on that, Monty Coleman was that dude. You had veterans, guys like him, that would speak to you. They don't have that now. When I first got here in 91, I don't know why I thought this, but for real, and even in minicamp, I just had a feel that, they were driving trucks. They weren't driving like no Lamborghinis and like that. So they like blue-collar workers, you know what I mean? So it's like, oh, we about to go to work in here.
Right.
And, and then the first time I heard Monty spoke, I was like, when he spoke, he was like, oh, I said, oh, this is real stuff right here. This is the real deal. And then he go out there on the field and he show it. And I swear to God, I'm going to tell you this quick story if you don't mind. The first game we had against Detroit at home. I'm from California and Southern California. I like playing in front of 100,000 folks. That's what we do at USC. We get here at the RFK, there's nobody in the stands.
Right.
Ain't nobody in the stands, and it's pregame.
Right.
And I said, Monty, man, where's everybody at? He said, oh, man, they outside. I said, man, you got to be kidding me. They ain't going to fill the stadium up in no 20 minutes. He said, Rick, trust me. Man, I said, whatever. We go back, we come back out, man, and I saw this stadium just up and down. I swear to God, I almost started crying because I said to the other side, the game was over with. I said, they have no clue that they lost the game yet.
Yeah.
Because of what the stands did to us, the fans. And I miss those days.
You know what was impressive about Ron Rivera in his introductory press conference that we were at?
Yeah.
He said, he paid homage to you guys in that pass. And it wasn't it wasn't just lip service. You could tell as a former player, you know, him playing with the Bears, he remembers what it was like at RFK Stadium. And he said he's going to need Redskins fans, Redskins Nation, to get that, you know, that duplication as far as where you are now.
And he followed that up by saying, we have to win on the field.
Oh, no, he did. They have to do their part.
And see, that's the thing that I love about Ron. Ron understands the fans have left. But he's not telling the fans, just come back.
Right.
He's saying, we need you back, but we got to put a better product out there.
Right.
He's holding himself and the team accountable. And if anybody listens to me on the radio and TV, I say accountability so much.
All the time.
That people want me to stop using the word. If you don't hold people accountable, they're going to do whatever the hell they want to do. If you hold them accountable, the one thing I know about athletes are just like kids, okay? Kids will do whatever you allow them to do. Athletes are going to do what you allow them to do. When I remember one time somebody, I forgot who it was, did something wrong, and Jay go, what am I supposed to do, discipline him? Yes.
Yeah.
You're the coach, right. Yeah, he said it in a press conference.
Yeah, he did.
You are the coach. So you dictate how – the fact that you asked that question and you didn't do anything, the next person said, I could do the same thing.
And they sure did.
And Ron's not going to play that. And the thing about it, people said this lately, and I know Ron will, like, shy away from it. They say he has a little bit of Joe Gibbs in him. Okay? Now, Ron's a little more fiery than Coach. Ron used a language that Coach Gibbs wouldn't use. Ron used the John Thompson language, you know, profanity and English. But he's going to live by a standard when he's around those guys that he wants them to live by. The last few coaches around here didn't do that.
So you become a product of what your coach is.
There you go.
And you guys were, when you played under Joe Gibbs, it was like you watched you play. You were perfectionists because that's what he was. And I heard you guys ran things over and over and over. So it got
boring. Start practice over.
Yeah, so it got
training camp, 1991, my first training camp. Didn't know what to expect. We go out in Carlisle, and it's humid. And this character over here says, now I'm dressed like I dress in California. I got my big pads.
Right.
I got pads everywhere. Oh, you coming out of that. Second practice. I said, man, you crazy. This is what I do. I ain't doing that. So you coming out. The second practice, I'm damn near naked. Man, but that was the Gibbs practices, though, man. We practiced hard. We practiced quick, too.
Oh, and by the way, you had 2-a-days. Oh, my goodness.
For 6 weeks.
That's not allowed now.
You go to camp July 14th. We break August 20th. And they trying to shorten up the training camp.
What's wrong with football right now? They don't practice. I'll be honest. I understand the concept, but I'll ask you this question. How was it when we had less technology, worse equipment? They're supposed to be so much better in shape than we are. We practiced for 6 weeks and played every game and then went to the playoffs and role grade people. Why is it now that they have everything under the sun, but they get more injuries? Think about that.
Mm-hmm.
So they use this excuse. We're bigger, stronger, and faster. There's nobody in the NFL today faster than Darryl Green.
Perhaps ever, all time.
There's nobody faster than Deion.
Right.
Okay, Monty Coleman was 4'4"9". At 6'4", 251 pounds with a 36-inch waist. Ain't nobody more fit than he is. You know, so when you start looking at all of that, I understand, but I think football
it's a mentality.
It's a weird game.
Yeah.
You have to get accustomed to being hit. It sounds crazy, but it's just like when you start doing stuff with your hands. If you're an outside worker, your hands begin to callous, and all of a sudden nothing bothers you. Rick watched me cook. I grab stuff with my hand, flip it over. You know, it's just I've been doing it all my life. But when these guys don't really go full speed until the first preseason game, and they do it for what, five plays, six plays?
I was gonna say, if that.
And then nobody plays a whole game until the regular season game. And we see more injuries in that first week or two than you see throughout the year.
You sure do.
They have to get the guys – you got to have – they have to let them have some level of contact.
So
and remember this, they would have those 14 days. Jay never used all of them.
I was just, I mean, you read my mind. I was literally just about to say, I mean, I'm in training camp, and I would say this last training camp, it was really bad. I mean, it was
Jay was on vacation, bro.
It was Club J.
He was already out.
It was Club J.
The one thing that I – everybody – I know a lot of the reporters would go, oh, man, Josh Norman is out here every day, 45 minutes to an hour. Let me ask you a question.
He's supposed to be.
If you practice as hard as you were supposed to, would you have energy to practice for an hour after practice?
Hey, you know what? I've never thought about that.
We refuse to go after practice. We'll go run some gassers, mm-hmm. but we refuse to go 25, 30, 40 minutes. Because Joe Gibbs will say, oh, I'm
you
not working
energy,
y'all hard enough.
Right.
You see what I'm saying?
Right, right.
My coach in college told me, if you can work out after practice, you've been sandbagging throughout practice. So I learned back then, give them everything I got. From Joe Gibbs, we only did an hour and 50 minutes.
But it was brutal.
But
though.
You were like in a track meet. And this is the thing about it. When you, like, I got to Philadelphia with Andy Reid, we didn't wear pads a lot, but I started asking him to put on pads because the way he had us running, it was like the pin relays. So I was like, look, coach, we can wear pads tomorrow. He said, no, we're going to get it. We're going to get our work.
So you guys are saying by week one, you were in shape.
Before week one, think about it. We approach preseason like this. I'm going to see if I can give you a full quarter first game. Second game, I'm trying to go two quarters. And we want to really come. The guys were asking to get the first drive out the locker room. And then in the third game, we're going full speed and going at you for three quarters.
Three quarters. Yeah.
But whenever those guys left, they wanted to be in the lead so we could know this is where we are. Now, what happens here, we never played guys three quarters. And every year when the season started, we lost everyone but one year.
Every
in
time.
6 years, mm-hmm. we were 1-5. You have to build for something. You know, why go out there and play in preseason game if you're not trying to find out where you are physically and mentally? When the season started, I knew – if they needed me to try and go to the house in the fourth quarter, I had the energy to go do it because I've done it. These guys weren't pushed. They about to get a rude awakening right now, though. I promise you that.
When I was with Frisco, you know, everybody here, they're like, oh, they don't practice with pads, this and that. Man, I go over there in 95, and they right. We don't practice with pads, but, man, we run. I mean, Jerry Rice is getting spatted up during a walkthrough. A walkthrough is – it's full. It's like a 15-minute practice.
Wow.
I'm saying, why you guys call this a walkthrough and nobody walking? Seriously. Because I went out there and it was like, no, you got to run. I'm like, oh, this is a walkthrough, though. No, it's not a walkthrough, really.
Well, that's what a walkthrough was here for the past few years. Oh, I mean, it was it was.
But you
got
to take it to the house every time with Frisco. That's why they got five championships, because they always in shape towards the end. They just – in the Frisco – I mean, New England. I had a conversation with a linebacker. I don't know which one he was. He left. He got cut. But he told me they practice full pads on Wednesday. They run heels after practice. On Thursday, they go half shells. They still hitting. They practice just like Gibbs. Why? Because they got an old school coach. They run after practice. Not only that, if someone jump off sides, the defense, not only the players running, the coaches are running too.
Oh, wow.
Around the goalpost. I said, that's old school.
Nah, I've never in my life seen that here, ever.
See, but you know what? But what it was is that whole notion that players take on the personality of the coach,
mm-hmm.
they did. You never saw me when I would be over there doing my radio show, and it'll be drizzling outside,
mm-hmm.
and they go in that bubble.
Mm-hmm.
He knows me. The forecast for the weekend is a torrential downpour, and it's drizzling, and you run inside?
Right.
What are you getting? Now, you hear about the Patriots putting oil on the ball, soaking
right,
the ball.
Right.
What are you getting ready for? What are you running from? But, see, that's the mindset. Coach Gibbs, we didn't have a bubble. And Coach Gibbs, like, the Giants practicing in this. I never knew the Giants had a bubble. I never knew the Eagles had a bubble. We just didn't have one. But he made all of us believe that every team we were playing – were in the bubble, well, not in the bubble, they were in the elements. And you get used to it, because I got here, like Monty Coleman, we all both have stories of Monty Coleman. The first time we played in a cold game, I had on sleeves. And he said, what's that? I said, I'm cold. He said, I'll be right back. So he went and got some scissors, and he cut the sleeves. and they dropped down to my wrist. He said, you can wear them like that. What am I going to fight money? So that's the last time I wore a long sleeve for the rest of my career. I got to the point, Rick could tell you, I ran out there. I had on my little glove. That was it. But I had no sleeves on, and I'm going barbaric. Because my arms were bigger than my legs, so I'm just going to listen to him. But we got used to it. I came from Louisiana. You know, I'm from 100-degree weather, 99% humidity and all that stuff. But I began to love the cold weather.
It's more like a mental block.
Because we practice in it. Like now, I rarely wear a coat. You know, I had on this little jacket today just because. But normally I have on a long sleeve shirt or a sweater, and that's it. Because I'm not planning on being outside that long. So I go in and out, keep moving.
Folks, I'm sitting here. This is good stuff, right? I'm sitting here with Brian Mitchell, Ricky Ervins, and they're the last guys to win a Super Bowl with the Redskins. And, you know, we'll take a break, but when we come back, you know, I have some more things I want to throw at them. How many of you think this gentleman over here should be in the Hall of Fame? Okay, yeah. So we're going to talk about that. We have to bring that up. I mean, this is one of the greatest guys, all-purpose yards. I think he's still top two in the league in history. So we've got to do our job to get him in the Hall of Fame. So we'll take a quick break. This is After Practice with myself, Lake Lewis. You can subscribe to this on Apple, Spotify, iHeartRadio, SoundCloud, you name it, it's on there. And also, yes, we do have some folks. If you wrote your name down, we're going to do a drawing when we come back where I'm going to pick five people, and I'm going to put you on our VIP list for training camp. So it'll be on me. So we'll take care of that when we come back. Hang tight. All right, folks. Welcome back. After practice with myself, Lake Lewis, joined with Washington Redskins greats, Brian Mitchell, Ricky Ervins, members of the 1991 season Super Bowl team, played the game in 1992. But still, these guys are the last of, well, I don't want to say that because that wouldn't be appropriate, but the last of the group.
And it's coming back. I really believe some of these guys on this squad right now, you know, Allen hates losing. Mm-hmm. Scary Terry hates losing.
Hates losing.
And I think when you get those guys that come from these winning programs, it's going to change up things. I think a lot of people got happy collecting the check.
We know they
but
did.
I've told people, Doc Walker hadn't played in over 30 years. He still benefits off of the Super Bowl that they won. I haven't played here since 1999, so basically 21 years. I can still go places, and this gets me into places. It takes care. I tell these guys.
Got them on the stage tonight.
Being in the NFL is cool. You know what I'm saying? Being in the NFL is cool. But if you're in the NFL and you're winning, then you get
life
to live that
good.
Life. You get to live the dream.
And
the
that's
stuff
why,
you think about, you live it.
But that's why I always tell people. People say, oh, why would a person want to go play for the Patriots and not get paid what they're worth? And I'm like, no, because
they'll get it.
Yeah, when you win, you can walk around Boston and you don't have to pay out of your pocket for anything.
There you go.
Forever.
And appearances, you get a lot more.
Forever. Folks, if you just joined us, we asked if you wanted to write your name down on a sheet of paper. We're going to do a little drawing. It's a makeshift drawing. But what it is during training camp, which will be coming up in July, you know, I have a VIP set up where I can bring certain fans out. And we got some people sitting out here that we've done this with before. So it's real. It's legit. And we'll get you out, VIP, for a practice. And you're going to need that VIP in August because it's hot. So the VIP gives you a chance to be in a tent, air-conditioned tent. You get some food. There's one thing I will say. Not to take away from this VIP drawing here, but I don't care for the VIP section being away from the main field, though. I'm not a big fan of that. But with that said, it's a good thing for you if you don't like the heat. So, exactly. So I tell you what, we'll get back to the drawing in like 5 minutes because Ed's out there taking some more names. So make sure you do that. Remember, I'm here every other Monday. We'll be back here on, I think, the 16th. Scheduled for that night should be Morgan Moses. that's not going to be a problem. Morgan Moses, starting right tackle for the Redskins, will be out. Kareem Copeland from the Washington Post will be coming out as well. And then we'll have some more folks come out. These guys came out short notice. I truly appreciate that. That's what friends do, you know, and they're giving you some good content on top of that. Remember, you can subscribe to this podcast on pretty much every major podcast carrier, whatever, if you have an Apple, you know, iPhone or Android, BlackBerry, whatever. I don't even know if they make BlackBerries, but still. Exactly. So
I've seen a BlackBerry not too long ago, about two
weeks
ago.
Well, they have a new one. Yeah. they have a new one.
Dude had a
I mentioned that Brian Mitchell should be in the Hall of Fame. And I want to ask you this, Brian, because I know you're not going to sit up here and, yeah. But
he should.
I'm starting to see a pattern with former Redskins greats just not getting the due that – do you think you guys are being held prisoner because of the success you guys had just as being a solid team in general under Joe Gibbs?
Some people make that excuse, mm-hmm. which I call an excuse. If you take my stats, my records, you know, my resume per se, mm-hmm. I did what I was supposed to do.
Right.
And the thing about it, when you look at the Patriots, they have a good team.
Mm-hmm.
But they have good players on that team.
Mm-hmm.
And I think the thing about it is that offensive line that went to the Super Bowl with three different running backs, three different quarterbacks, you got one guy representing it? That makes no sense.
None whatsoever.
Now, I can tell you this. Jerry Jones promotes his team.
Yes.
All the time.
Yes.
And I understand we promote the current team.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But we got to find a way to start pushing out what happened here. It was strange to me when I – and this is before Dan Snyder. When I left here and went to Philly – they were like, man, do you know where you rank in all time in the NFL? I'm like, no. I didn't have a clue. I didn't know. When I left here, I had 16,900 yards. When I left here, and I was already in the top 20. And I didn't know that.
You had no clue.
Nobody ever mentioned it to me. But every week, I was in Philly for 3 years. The PR guy, every week, they were like, I could hear him over the intercom. Brian Mitchell just moved up to another. If he just gets a yard and fall forward, he'll break another record this week. They were promoting it.
Yeah.
And you hear a lot of teams do that with their team. And I think we have to do a better job of that overall as a franchise.
Do you think that starts with Dan?
I think it starts with Dan. It starts with a lot of people. The media here, I think a lot of people, if you don't have a vote, you don't talk about it. But if you talk
about it,
you all have colleagues mm-hmm, mm-hmm. in different areas. When they're promoting their guys, promote our guys. Joe Jacoby should have been in the Hall of Fame.
Long time ago.
You know, if you're putting – Gary Clark is that type of guy.
I think Gary should be in the Hall of Fame.
So it's like from what I've learned, watching Art Monk, I don't get upset about much. Art Monk should have been first ballot. Took him 8-9 years. And I watch him be a gentleman – professional about it, never
and
got
isn't
upset.
Isn't that what you want in the Hall of Fame as opposed to
you think
somebody
you,
else
you think that,
that. Right.
And some people, you know.
Right, exactly.
So that's why, you know, I have learned to take a step back because if I allow myself to be who I am, I'll never get in because I'll probably curse everybody out. So I'm trying my best to be a nice guy.
But that's what the fans are for. And I think, Redskins Nation, we just talked about it. They've been disgruntled over the past several seasons, past several years.
But they respect mm-hmm. the good days.
They do.
They respect the good
they
players.
Do.
They promote do. The hell. Listen to me, man. It's not a place I go in this area that people don't come up and say something positive. They understand. And I think that's what the young guys and what I'm learning now. I watch Terry McLaurin.
Man, phenomenal.
I think everybody on this team can learn from that dude.
Phenomenal.
He reaches out to the veteran players. Mm-hmm. He wants info.
Mm-hmm.
He wants to understand the history and how to be better, how to be the Redskin he want to be. Like Ricky said earlier, Big Ray Brown, he'd always say, everybody's a professional. If you're getting paid to do a job, you're a professional. He said, but everybody's not a pro. Pro is that guy that's going to do what he's supposed to do on the field, off the field, all the time.
Right.
And that young dude, rookie, he is that way already.
He became the leader of the team by week 8 instantly.
How does that happen?
I mean, some people just know greatness. Some people know a leader when they see it, and you follow suit. And I think with him, it doesn't hurt that he wasn't this high draft pick. He was a guy that showed you. I mean, I go back to training camp. I was just like, there's something special with this guy. He's doing something that the original number one draft pick and receiver, Josh Doctson, this guy came in and just basically took his job. He just took his job from him. He just snatched it, put it in his pocket. Right. That's exactly what he did. Josh Doctson's bounced around now, so that's a whole nother story. But, he's currently on the roster of the Jets.
Who's
he's
that?
Not with the Jets. He's so
who's that?
Josh Doctson.
Is he still in the league?
That's what we're saying.
Seriously.
He's with the
Dude,
Jets.
When he was here, I was like, come on, man. Every year, something was wrong with him.
This is a little inside joke with Ricky and me. So I was trying to wait and see how long we were going to be on this set before he had mentioned something about USC. Do you remember he did that early?
I didn't do that.
Yes, you did.
When?
You said that. You said, I played in front of 100,000 people. That's what we do at USC. I just was waiting to see how long he was going to do that.
His head covers on his golf club.
He did.
Look, his head covers on his golf club, USC, and I whip him every time.
Listen. I get you sometimes
now.
In the first nine, though. I know. Listen. It's coming.
I didn't even say my school yet, and that's what I've been accused of. I didn't even say it yet.
I'm saying on this podcast, I will beat B. Mitch in golf this year. Best believe that. And when I do, I'm coming on your show and his show.
On the front nine, he's going to beat me. And in the back
I
nine,
need to see.
Everybody go to track meet, really go, whoop, whoop. When they start sucking him up, that's how I'm going to get him.
I want to see. So this is a guy you play with. You guys are friends. Why don't you think he's in the Hall of Fame yet?
You know what? It's bias, man. It's too political. To me, when you look at when you make the NFL, all those players are elite.
Mm-hmm.
Every person that makes the NFL. What makes a Hall of Famer is that when you could play at that level that you play at for an extended period of time, B has done that. If you look at all the Hall of Famers, they in there like plus 8, plus 10. You
mm-hmm.
know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
But they had that high level. They kept playing that.
Mm-hmm.
You have some guys that get content, they get in the NFL, and they happy with that. And they don't get to that level. But B. Mitch has passed that level every single year that he's played.
And you've done it on multiple teams, too.
If
That's
you got kickers
thing.
In there, why not have a special team, a kick return, a punt return?
I mean, it's coming because with Brian, with Devin Hester, you can't deny these guys of the greatness that they had. They changed games on you.
It's 2020.
Well, I just think the league right now is trying to figure out a couple things because to me, I don't know if it's just me, but it seems like the criteria to get in the Hall of Fame, this guy has the numbers. It's proven that he should be in there, and there's some other guys that are getting in there.
So if you got the numbers, what's the problem now?
The problem is the criteria, I think, it's not etched in stone. Like when you talk about the NBA Hall of Fame,
okay. There's
no question those guys are Hall of Famers. I don't know what the NFL, what is the criteria? Do you need to be an all-pro or a pro bowler?
But if you're hitting these numbers, though, every year you surpass a lot of those guys that's in the Hall of Fame.
Right.
And your numbers are much better. How come you're not in it?
I personally believe that the Redskins have been blacklisted. I truly believe that. Because you guys have, you can't, and I say this for all the young people in here, it shouldn't be that many because you need to go to school tomorrow, but I always say, if you're under 35, you don't know the history of this franchise with you guys. You don't remember those heydays. So I say to the young people, you guys at one point were battling it out with the 49ers, the Giants. You guys were dynasties. There were three, four dynasties playing against each other at the same time. The run you had over a 10-year period, I mean, it's unmatched by most franchises. And you're telling me that you only have three, four, five guys maybe off those great teams over a decade? That's just – it's something wrong with that picture right there.
It's political. But look, man, I'll tell you what. You know, when we won back in 91, it was so special to go 11-0 because you get a chance to see the whole town just come together.
Yeah.
Crime was down.
Yeah.
Everybody was friendly. We traveled to different places. You got about like 100 people, you know, coming to our hotel when we travel away. If this town could just start doing that, just little by little, winning.
Well, when you guys saw, not to cut you off, but when you saw the Nationals win the World Series or the Capitals, you guys already experienced that.
Oh, man. Oh, man.
Many times over.
Yeah.
And everybody like, man, it'll never be one bigger than this. I say, if a Redskins go to the Super Bowl,
no, it's no comparison.
It's going to, it would envelop all of that. The Nats and the Caps together.
I said that on the last one.
They wouldn't be close.
I just said here on the last, some of you were here. We talked about it. Where's Carita? Bingo.
When we were on the mall.
I got.
And it was cold. Mm-hmm. They had more people out there than they had for the Nats deal. Believe me.
So someone over here behind me, I'm not trying to put her out there because she's one of our reporters. Does a great job covering the Mystics and the Wizards. Carita. And you've seen her, you know, covering the Redskins. She's not from here, so I got to give her benefit of the doubt. She's from Jacksonville. She's from Duval. But anyway, sorry. But she did say, we did a little poll, like, who's still the top team in D.C.? And she, you know, she just, there is no criteria. It's the Redskins. It's just flat out. I'll
tell you who you find out the top team is. When you go to the radio and the TV stations and you see how much money the people that are marketing, how much they pay to do the on the Redskins games compared to the other games, they are number one.
It's a lot.
by a long stretch.
And I say this. I go by what leads the sports and what ends it. And what leads is normally the Redskins, win, lose, or draw. We're already talking about it. I'm part of the media. I'm sitting here with – this is what we do. The Capitals still, you know, have a chance to get a Stanley Cup, another one this year. The Nationals are spring training, you know, trying to defend a championship.
We're only talking about the Astros.
Nobody's talking about it. Yeah, well, no one's even mentioning that right now, you know. The Wizards, I mean,
Bradley Beal's doing great. 18 straight games, 25 points or more. But he scored 22 last night in the first.
He did. Yeah. And how many of those are W's, though?
Oh.
Okay, so again,
I'm just saying. When the Redskins, even if they don't win, they will push the needle.
Of course.
And that's when you know people want, they get upset at them when they lose.
Oh,
the other team, they get over it quickly.
People get really
get
upset.
Over it quickly.
So I have some names here. Did I get everyone? Okay, Ed's got some. Okay, we have some more right here. Ed, if you can get young lady right here. All right, so we'll put this. So what this is, folks, is a drawing for, I'm going to pick five names out of the hat. And it's going to be for VIP for training camp, which means I'll put you on my list and we'll get you in there. Just so you know, training camp is in Richmond, okay? So I want people saying, how come I can't get in the FedEx Field? And this is for training camp, okay? All right, just want to let you know that. You're going to have to travel down there. And then you'll see these gentlemen down there as well, you know. So, and what I do for training camp is I will do my best after practice to bring guys over so you can meet, you know, a lot of the players, current players, and take pictures and all that good stuff. So, all right, so we're gonna do this. You guys want to draw one each?
One each, all right. All right, who I got here?
All right. Is there a Zane? Going once, going twice. Okay. All right. So we have a Shonda or Shonda. All right. All right. So Shonda's on there.
How you say that?
Shonda.
Shonda.
Shonda player. Okay. So if you don't mind doing this,
I had never seen no CH.
If you don't mind doing this, if he can have a. Have her take a picture with Ricky up here, okay?
Come on, baby girl.
Because the last thing I want is somebody say, I didn't get my VIP. All right. There you go. Yep. You go right up there. And then I'll read another one out. I'll read mine out. I have a...
I picked somebody that wasn't here.
Okay. So Brian picked someone that wasn't here. I have Steven Johnson. Is there a Steven Johnson? See, how are you going to put your name on the paper and then disappear? All right. So that's... All right, so we'll just put that right there for there. All right, so we can draw one more.
Oh, no. All right,
so Terry. Brian, take a picture with Terry. All right, and I'm going to draw one more. We still have two more. Okay, I want to make sure that I say this properly. Fatmisha. Did I say that right? Fatmisha. Famada? Famada? Is there a Famada here? All right. So, Famada Wuri. Okay, so that's three down. Okay, so here you go. Somebody going to win by default. Here you go, Brian. Use your mic. Okay, you got to come down.
Oh, you got to come down.
All right.
You still want me to do this one?
All right, so Steven Johnson was up in the rafters in the nosebleeds. All right, so we'll have him down. Okay.
A-Rod. Aaron. Remember that? You ever seen that?
Of course.
Ooh, that's hilarious.
And then I have Ivy Rector. Okay. All right.
Aaron, so.
Well, I mean, right now we got four. Well, is Aaron Johnson, was that the gentleman?
That was
Steven Johnson. Aaron Johnson, you have him? Where is he?
Oh, no.
No, sir. Yeah, we have you. You have one more. Go ahead.
Brendan.
All right. There we go. So I'm going to tell you what.
You don't need no damn VIP.
You know, it's four more left in here. I'm just going to do it. I'm going to do it. It's fine. I'm going to give it to everybody. Melba. There we go. All right. So I'm going to take a picture with Melba. All right. And then I got a bunch of people. Who's this? Daryl Escato. He's probably shopping. All right. So. All right. Got one more. Mark Shields is gone. I like this drawing. This is good. Don't worry about getting a whole bunch. Right. They're going to come up afterwards. Did you call me? David Betancourt. All right. So he's gone, too. It's like, what, five or six names over there where they just disappeared. They just left. And then, of course, T. Tamika Rector. There you go. All right. Awesome. All right. So we'll just make sure I get pictures with everyone. And, yeah, we're going to keep this thing rolling for a few more minutes. Huh? Oh, Steven. So, Steven, who called Steven? It was Ricky. So you got to take a picture with Steven over there. All right. I appreciate that. And, again, just so you know, every other Monday we're here trying to do something different. Putting this on the stage for you in the eatery. You can eat here in the seats if you want to come over sometime. So we just try to do something different. Brian Mitchell, the legend, is with us tonight. Ricky Ervins, two Super Bowl winners. You know, you got to make sure when you take a picture with them, they show the rings, you know, because you haven't seen those in a long time. 28 years. Now, I'm going to put you two on the spot. I already know the answer, but it's something that I do think about sometimes. You guys were the last champions, Redskins, and people, when they think of the good times, they go right back to you guys. I mean, it's a tricky question. It's not to sound selfish, but do you guys ever think that if this team, like this year, won a Super Bowl, do you feel like you guys would kind of be, not like afterthoughts, but the glory that you guys have had all these years would kind of be pushed to the side a little?
It pushed you back in the spotlight.
Okay.
Because when they discuss it, they're going to say first team since. And I know in Philadelphia, they won their first.
Right.
And everyone said that about the guys. All these guys that had gone to these NFC championship games, they lost it.
Right.
What would happen if another team won it? Well, I just went up there yesterday for an autograph signing. I live here, okay? I played there 3 years.
Right.
I had as many people in my line as anybody that just won the Super Bowl there.
Wow.
So it's like when you've had success in an area, they don't forget that.
Okay.
Now, they're going to add them on to it. They'll be happy for them. But they're going to remember because like I said earlier, Doc Walker hadn't played in 30 years.
And still living the life.
And he still lives it.
Living
Joe
it.
Theismann, you know, all those guys. Look at Rigo. Those guys are still loved, even though we won it in 1992.
Mm-hmm.
They're still loved, the guys before, and I think it'll still be the same way.
Okay, so now I'm this is the second part
but
to this.
I pull for him to go win one.
Okay, because that's
what I want to see it because I get sick of going. Look, I like bragging on my people. And when I go around this country and around the world and I have on anything red skin, they go, y'all don't win. You know how embarrassing that is? I need bragging rights, man. So I want them to win.
So, and that's the other thing I was going to say. That was the second part of it. You guys are competitive. I know both of you. You already heard them talking about the golf. That's just that. So do you think if you were one of these young guys now, you would just get tired of hearing about what you guys did, where you'd want to do something to etch your name in stone?
What I would do if I were one of these young guys is the same thing I did when I got here. I'm going to work hard day and night to win one. Okay? Like Terry McLaurin was like, let me see that. He say, I want to get one of those. I'm going to put the work in. Too many guys, too many people in the world, they see a successful person and instead of striving to be, they hate. They want to say, they start finding excuses. Okay? We got it by working.
Mm-hmm.
They need to do the same thing.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and that's the whole thing about it. When you hear these veteran players, these older players talking about the young guys, we believe they cut corners. So, but when you find a guy that doesn't cut corners, we praise him.
Like I tell
you. Terry McLaurin gets praised.
Oh, absolutely.
Jonathan Allen gets praised.
Absolutely.
Yeah, but if you got a coach that won't, if you putting the work in, but you got a coach like Jay, how you going to win? You can put the work in all you want. But if you're going to coach the way he did, you still ain't going to win. You're just going to be a good player.
You know,
but you're not going to win. You have to have that system. You have to have that coach, that program.
Mm-hmm.
Now you put the work in and see what happens.
You know,
you got to be on the same page.
I have to say this, man. Just for years, you know, I supported Jay at times. I did. I thought he was good at certain times for the team. But then you just saw the lack of discipline at times. And I just with Brian, I just go to the press box. I don't know how many games, man, something happened, and he was already looking at me, just shaking his head. And he's like, I'm not going to say nothing. And people would think we were hating. You know, like, nah, you guys just don't like him. And it wasn't that. It was just, man, I can tell you so many things I saw at practice, just –
dude,
guys doing calisthenics and other guys are off to the side chilling.
No. Those guys that thought.
Oh, I'm telling
those
you.
Those guys that thought we were hating and mm-hmm. didn't like him,
mm-hmm.
they only praised because they liked him. And that's the problem. See, I don't subscribe to doing something for you to like me. My job in the media is to tell you what I believe.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what I've been doing since I started doing it while I was playing.
Mm-hmm.
My job is not to stay in good graces with the coach or the team or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
If you don't want me to say something negative, don't do it. Okay?
Don't give me a reason to say it.
The thing about me, my dad told me, don't ever fall in love with mediocrity. I love success. And those people that love mediocrity, I hate them. So whether
like
you were
that.
A coach, a player, or whoever, I can't stand mediocrity.
And it was mediocrity
so
here for a while.
If they're not doing the things that they're supposed to. See, like, I hear guys, like, they talk about how strong guys are, this, that, and the other. I'll take my numbers in the weight room and put it against anybody on the football team, and most of them will be linemen because most of the running backs couldn't touch me. The receivers don't even think about it. I lift weights with the big dudes because
mm-hmm.
that's what I needed that because the way I played was crazy. You know, I dance, shy away from contact for what? You know? And that's why I put my body through hell from March when we started all the way to the season start so I can go out there and do what I did. A lot of these guys, I watch them, they don't stretch. And that stretching is more important than lifting. It's more important than running.
That's what I'm telling you, man.
Some of these guys look like, you know, they walk around, look like Tony Atlas. But they can't run.
A lot of people may not know who Tony Atlas is. I do.
Bodybuilder.
Right.
look, these guys are more concerned about their bodies, how they look, what time they getting out, what they going to drive, what they going to – man, they're not serious about it. You cannot be serious about this game when you're doing that type of stuff. B had to put his body through work like that because of what he was doing on the field. He had to, like – and I tell my kids, I train, you know, these sprinters at this school, I said, being great costs you something. It hurts. Mm-hmm. It hurt being great. Mm-hmm. So you have to understand, when you run a track, it's going to cost you something, so deal with the pain if you want to be great.
You have to sacrifice something. You got to give up something important to you to be great. You just do.
Yeah, do. But you're doing it, though. You know what I'm saying? I do the same thing. I mean, just that we cut from a different cloth.
So both of you guys, you know, you won special teams at 1.2, yep. Returning kickoffs. I remember that.
Yep.
The new setup they have in the XFL, the kickoff they have, do you like that?
I have not seen it. What about you?
I've seen it, and I think what it does is it keeps the kickoff in the game. Mm-hmm. And if the special teams coaches had any type of sense, you could have a lot of touchdowns off of that.
Oh, right.
Because everybody is in one area.
Exactly.
And the thing about the way when I returned, you had different waves to get through. It's one wave and the kicker.
And that's it.
And if you get through the first, what they do, they have people, they line up, and they like
I think it's 10 yards apart.
They're like, maybe closer.
I think it's 10.
But they're on the 35-yard line.
Absolutely.
So even the coverage team, they're down here. So when they kick the ball,
everybody has to wait.
We can't move until you catch the ball. Now, if the ball hit the ground, we have to wait 3 seconds.
You do.
Then we can go.
Right.
But if you catch the ball, remember I used to always say catch it running into it? So if these guys catch the ball and time it coming into it, and all your guy have to do is shield him. The problem is everybody on kickoff want to try to knock somebody down. Shield them and you get through there.
It's over. There's no one.
So it's all one-on-one blocks. It's no double teams. And they're kicking it from the 30,
yep.
Which means you're going to return it. Right now, the way the NFL has it set up, it's no returns. It's boring. So I love it. I
think
might
the
have
NFL
35
should adopt
touchdowns
it.
In that thing. Yeah. I'm telling you. I
would like the NFL to adopt that. But it would be a sign of somebody did something better, so I don't know if they will. At least not right
away.
Well,
if you look at the NFL, the camera on the –
that came
the
from
XFL
that previous.
Had that before.
They did.
They had that.
They
so
did.
If it's going to improve the game, do it. Yeah. I don't care who did it.
And I think because everyone's so close, it would take away the real hard collision.
Yeah, but see, that's what the NFL say, that they want to get rid of the collisions.
Yeah, but they want another game.
See, this is – but they make fans think that – because they're not returning, they're not hitting. People still get knocked to the ground when they don't return it and it's kicked into the end zone. Your job is to block.
And you're going
to
take a hit.
So it's two people coming to block. If I see you running down full speed, looking in the air, ooh, ear hole, I'm getting you. So you're going to knock the guy down. So they still have contact the way the NFL has, not even when it's not a return.
See, it just the NFL, the whole thing with the, you know, the concussions and being sensitive to you guys as players. Why are you adding another game? We already know it's money.
Well, it's a money grab, and you know that they have it built up to where the 18th game is coming too, maybe 10 years down the road. But ultimately, I've always felt the game of football. We know how tough it is. How about you lean towards guaranteed contracts? And then you remove – but this is – the NFL has relinquished themselves of liability.
Yeah.
When they had that $760 million settlement, there's a clause in that say the current guys and guys coming in the future cannot sue the NFL.
A lot of people don't know that.
See, that's what I'm saying. So they have relinquished themselves. So my thing is, you've already relinquished yourself. I mean, I understand what the public says, but I can tell the public there are more concussions in bike riding and cheering in soccer than in football. Way more. So, but the NFL game gets attacked. You think hockey don't get concussions?
Oh, of course they do.
They have ice, glass, and, you know, they go at it. But the NFL gets overly scrutinized. And listen, I say this. I believe doctors don't know the whole gist of CTE. I don't know, but I say this. I watch people smoke every day and never get lung cancer. I watch people that don't smoke get lung cancer. Some people are preconditioned to get things. Mm-hmm. And I had one concussion. There have been people with multiple concussions. Is everybody going to get CTE? I don't think so.
No.
Because there's too many people that have played this game. On the football team we played on, over 20 guys played 16 years or more. That Super Bowl team, they played over 16 games or more. Over 20 guys. but most of these guys, most of those guys are successful. Now, yes, it can happen to where someone get it. And I hope they get the test where they can test people while they're living.
Sure.
Because right now you can't test a person until they're dead.
Until they're dead.
If you can find a way to check out the way the protein is in the brain and all that type, I majored in chemical engineering. I think about this stuff a lot. If they can find a way to get that while people are living, then you can start to treat guys for different things. You know, but Junior Seau, the guy from the Steelers, Dave Jurison.
In Kansas City.
You know, yep. And I look at all of those guys, yes, they played football. That's a common denominator. But they also were dealing with some issues.
They sure were.
Financial issues and other stuff.
Mm-hmm.
So I try not to do it publicly all the time, but the question is, did the concussion make it happen, or did the stress and the scrutiny of what you were dealing with, mm-hmm. did that make it happen?
Right.
You know what I'm saying? And I think people would think you're being disrespectful if you ask the question, but no, I'm only being right, because this game of football gave me the life that I have. It allowed me to do stuff for my kids and my family that I wasn't going to be able to do.
Right.
You know, and I love the game. And if I can play now, I will be playing today. At 52, I'll be trying to go out there and run that thing right now. Because the way they get paid today, hell, I might try it anyway.
And he probably thinks he won't get hit the same way either.
Listen. It's tough. It's a tough game. It beats you up. But you don't have to play it.
Do you guys feel like, and I already know the answer, I'm sure you're going to know it too as soon as I say it. Do you feel like the guys today are as tough as you guys are, or they're just not allowed to be?
This is the way I answer that question. They are as tough as we are. But when you give me options, okay, we didn't have the option. So we chose play hard or get cut. Today, you have an extra option. I can say I have a concussion. They can't make me play. Back in the day, it was a spine, remember? If a guy say he had a spine injury, you had to hold him on that roster as long as he till that spine injury was gone.
Wow.
And you couldn't. But now, concussion is that new thing. You know, you watch a guy get a concussion, and that's why I say some people are preconditioned. One guy get a concussion, he's back in a week. Another guy get a concussion, he's back in 6 weeks.
Jordan Reed
gets one, he's out for the year.
Right.
So, but you don't know, and doctors don't know. But I believe that they've given them options. You know, when I was growing up, I remember I was like in the 7th, 8th grade. That's when they started giving you that 1-800 number that you can call if your parents spank you or whatever. And my dad gave me, he says, here's that number that the people want you to have. He said, you better remember 911 too. And I'm like, why? He said, because if you call that number, you're going to need to call this one. He said, as long as I'm taking care of you, I make the rules here. So now kids run their parents. Why? Because they have an option. The NFL keeps giving them options, and the NFLPA, they keep giving them options. Mm-hmm. So now instead of pushing through, see, the difference between Ricky and I, as rookies, when we came in, we had to push ourselves beyond a level.
Okay.
Today, they don't even have to get to it. Think about that.
Well, if they haven't seen it either, if they haven't seen the blueprint, you talked about Monty several times,
yeah.
Daryl Green. If you didn't see what success really, truly was, you wouldn't know how to emulate it.
My dad is a military guy, and I respect military people. So anytime I meet a Green Beret or somebody that's been recon, I like to sit down and talk to them. And they tell me, in Navy SEALs, mm-hmm. how they push themselves to damn near the brink of death.
Mm-hmm.
So when they get out there on those battlefields, they know where they can go. And that's the type of people we want fighting for us and protecting our freedoms.
Mm-hmm.
When you're on a football field, you need to push yourself to where you know where you can go.
Right.
You know, I've been running to where I'm like, damn, I'm almost about to pass out. But then all of a sudden, you get a second win. Mm-hmm. So next time I'm in that situation, I know I got something coming. Mm-hmm. But what if I never push myself there? When I start feeling that, if I never been there, I quit. I stop. And I think that is the difference between people in the past and people today. We've been close. They have, because I'm going to tell this story about Rick. We used to run this 12-minute this 12-minute conditioning test. So Ricky hadn't done his yet. So we run it, and you get on the treadmill, and they start at 5.5 miles per hour.
I think we start at 5.5. Yeah.
And then after 2 minutes, they move it to 6. Then they move it to 6.5. Then they move it to 7.
And keep in mind, this is my first time doing this.
So Darryl Green had taught me, say, if you don't pump your arms, your lower back won't get tight on you. So I'm running, Ricky, why you not pump your arms? I got through mine. So now it's his turn.
And it looks easy.
He's running.
It's only 12 minutes.
So D-Boy stands up and put his arm. He said, what are you doing? He say, you'll see. About 2 minutes later, he had to catch him because he had never been there.
Yeah.
But he got it eventually.
Yeah, that was tough.
We pushed you to get it. You know,
those were the days, man.
That treadmill, man.
I hated the treadmill. Why are we doing this? For real. But I knew why.
It was the dumbest thing in the world. You're never going to be running like that on the football field. But it was a test that you did not know anything about, and you had to practice it, or you weren't going to get there. So it just taught you a different level of where you can go. When North Turner came in, we ran 14.40s. And I had to run it in 5.2.
Yep.
I can run 14.40s in 5.2 right now.
Yeah.
when I was in my top shape, come on, man. All we did was take off, hit 20 yards, cruise.
But you know what? That was conditioning, though. Today, these kids don't do conditioning. They're, you know, like B said, you have to push yourself, and your practices has to be the hardest thing ever. So when Sundays come, it's the easiest. You can't wait for Sundays because now you get to just go ahead and just have a great time because you put that work in during that whole week. It has to be hard. It has to be brutal. And when we played with Coach Gills, man, it was tough. Training camp was just
was
brutal.
But like today, I get up every morning, 5:30, 6 o'clock to go work out because my daughter one day, I was tying my shoes and I was breathing hard. And she said, Daddy, you breathing hard tying your shoes? So I decided to go up. See, I got on the scale and I was a lot of pounds more than I was supposed to be. So I started working out.
Yeah.
And I'll be totally honest with you. I go in the morning. I get on. I try to do a mile or more. And then I train. And then I do a run or a walk run after. And I try to push the time better every time.
Yep.
So after finish lifting upper body or lower body, I run again. Because when I was playing, after we would lift, most guys would run before they lift. I would run before, work out, and then run after. Because in the fourth quarter, you want to know that you could dig into that reserve. You know, when the car tells you you're almost at E, we all know we got 20 miles of reserve left in that thing. I know I got 20 more yards of reserve left in me. Most guys don't even know. When they see that light come on, they quit. They stop.
This is so funny. B's 52, I'm 51, and we still train like we still playing. That's crazy.
That's all you know.
Exactly.
That's all you know.
I mean, I do the same
thing
every
morning.
Well, Ricky,
we just got him to start walking on the golf course. Dude would never walk. I'm like, man, you crazy.
I don't need to walk. I got the cart. I run too much. You know what I mean? I run every day, so I don't need to walk. But I realize walking is cool, though.
It's cool. It's fun.
Yeah. You get the finally did it. So, yeah.
I wanted to give a shout out to somebody over there, my friend Bert over here from Nike. He introduced us all when we came on tonight. But this guy's a pro. Golfer. What's your scratch, two?
Not yet.
Ricky,
what's your handicap?
Handicap.
Hey, you know, Leslie Shepard, a good friend of mine, played with the Redskins. So we used to go down to Virginia Beach. To Bruce Smith's golf tournament.
Mm-hmm.
So we walk in, and the lady say, what's your handicap, sir? He say, what you mean, handicap? I've been walking like this. She said, don't I leave golf? He said, I don't know, it's my first time on a golf course. That was funny as hell.
There's always the golf tournaments. A lot of people don't realize this, but that the video, you remember, Brian, the video of Trent Williams missing the ball and spinning?
Yeah.
That was myself and Chris Wilson filmed that. And Trent was like, what y'all going to do with that? You already know.
We're going to show
that
it.
That thing was on ESPN's not so top 10 for like 2 weeks, and it was bad. I mean, he swung at it and coiled up.
Dude,
but you know what? That dude's an athlete because he didn't go down.
Oh, he's an athlete.
He caught himself.
Yeah, he's an athlete.
Speaking of that, because I know we've got about 5-10 minutes left before we wrap up. I know it's getting late. We appreciate you coming out. Brian Mitchell, Ricky Ervins. I mean, they've been great, right? I mean, this is good stuff here. When you think about Trent, it would be easy to say that he should be back. They cleaned house. I mean, I give Dan Snyder a lot of credit for doing something that he hadn't done.
Yeah.
I don't want to hear, he's fired coaches before. He got rid of some guys that we know were his boys.
Yes.
Were friends that he hung with. For him to make those moves, that should tell Trent that they're trying to change things here.
Yeah, it should. And I think when you look at it, it was because of the Bruce and the training staff.
Absolutely.
Where they got rid of them.
Yeah, absolutely.
And now you change the reason. my mom and dad always gave me these little tips. My mom said, when you keep changing the reason that you're doing something, you don't really have one. You're just trying to find other stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And I think now it comes down to, I understand it's a business. I don't fault Trent for what he's doing.
No, because you
want to get the most money you can while you're playing.
Absolutely.
But the team also has to understand that, I got to get the most players for the amount of money I have to spend. And if I give you way more, you're under contract for 2 years.
Mm-hmm.
I can't just go and give it just because. So they're going to have to find something that works for both people. If it doesn't get that, what I'm hearing, it wants $20 million. Ain't happening on no team this year. Not at this moment, I don't think. That's not happening.
Never going to happen.
12-5.
Yeah, there's no way. I mean, they're going to have to. I think the max that they could get him where it's reasonable.
I think the guarantees
13,
is what.
Yeah.
When you get to his level.
At this stage in his career, too.
But how good he was. And this, when people always say, he only played 11, 12 games. Trent would have played every game if they were in the playoffs.
Oh, we know that.
He sat down because they were out of the playoff and they told him to do it.
Right.
But the thing about it is, a guy playing with 2 years left with no guarantees, and you are an all-pro, that seems a little...
And you did something to him,
yeah,
too.
Yeah, that seems like you disrespected me.
Yeah.
And I understand, and I know people go, listen, I have a lot of people call my radio show telling me, at my job, I say, remember, your job is not like this job.
It's not.
Okay, at your job, you don't make more money than your boss. At this job, they make more money than their bosses
right.
do.
Right.
So it's a different ball game, and the owners make a lot of money because they have an agreement with the players. So that's why the money happens like that. But this is a different business.
And Trent's a guy, though, that you think about Dwayne Haskins. We talked about him. You bring him back, you might see more things out of him that you didn't know he was capable of.
Oh yeah.
And that's something that they're gonna have to weigh and put in consideration. And let's face it, Brian, this is a team that has some holes that they've got to fill.
Yeah.
You don't want to overpay for one player, but if there is a player that you do want to compensate accordingly, that's the guy right there.
I call a left tackle the eraser. He erases problems for your quarterback.
Right.
When your quarterback can drop back and not think about what's happening back there, he can perform.
And Dwayne has never seen that luxury as a Washington Redskin.
Right.
No offense to Donald Penn or anyone else, but that's Trent Williams. We're talking about an elite player at his position. So we'll see if they get that done. Real quick, and wrapping up in like 2 minutes or so, I want to ask you, just give me an over and under on the amount of wins. I'll throw the total out there, and you tell me over or under for the 2020 Redskins. 8 wins.
I think you're right on the head. I thought last year they won 3 games.
Mm-hmm.
And if we look at some of those games, they lose because of a dumb penalty here, dumb penalty there. Last year, they should have won 5 to 6 games.
Easily.
Even with all those problems.
Easily.
I'm thinking that 8 games is about right, but it's going to come down to how quick do they fall into line with Ron and how can they effectively get this old line working.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
If they get the old line, if they get Trent back, mm-hmm. I'll go over. I'll go 9.
Because that's you guys have seen. I've said I think the Redskins right now, and that's with Trent coming back, are sitting at 9-7.
I'll look at that.
Which in that division means you're playing meaningful football in December with a chance to maybe – I mean, that division, no one's going to run away from anyone in that division.
No.
The offensive line coach is my guy from USC, Masco. Woo! Man.
You see that, really, right?
I'm just letting you know.
He started the show with it. He's going
to
end
guys
it with
to play. So I think it'd be good that if Trent come back, man, there's going to be some serious thing going on, man. He knows how to get you to play.
So what's the over and under? You think?
I'm with B. I think I could see even 9 wins.
Okay.
Because, you know, even though they struggled last year, they were still in some games, a lot of games.
And most
they
of
just, they just got worn out.
They played San Francisco as hard as anyone.
Yes, they did.
Outside of Kansas City. Seriously, they played them tough.
They didn't have that foundation. So now with Ron's system, his program, people buying into it, you have to buy into it first. And once they do that, man, I think we're gonna be all right.
Okay. Folks, we got to wrap it up. It's 8:30 on the nose, and I told him I would make sure we shut down accordingly. But, again, can you please thank our guests, Brian Mitchell, Ricky Ervins, for coming out. And, you know, they have us doing this on Mondays, so I appreciate everybody who stuck around. Starbucks, I think it's Jess over there from Starbucks, gave us the caramel and what was that? What did you?
Macchiato
and a medicine bowl. Never heard of it. But yeah, I never heard of it. But still, it was good. Remember, you can subscribe to this podcast. All you have to do is go to Apple Music, Google Podcasts, Spotify. We're on whatever your carrier you're looking for. We're on there. You know, as always, you know, we've got some people that have come out to support. Appreciate you coming out. Again, thank you for all my well wishes. My family appreciates that. And, yes. Oh, there she is over there. We appreciate the coffee. Kept us going here. So, Serge, guys, Kelvin, Ed, you know, Carita, Roberto, Jack, I mean, Terry. Oh, yeah, and if you definitely, well, there's a lot of people that did not come back to get their VIP, but the people who did, we're going to take a picture with you. We're going to get your name. We're going to write it on my list. You have to wait till July, but it's real. A lot of these folks out here can attest. I will do this. It's not going to be a problem. You got to come to Richmond, though. So, as always, I appreciate you coming out. Make sure you get home safely, and we'll see you in 2 weeks. Take care.